We gather on this fifth Sunday of Lent. Maybe we can make a claim it's the last regular Sunday. Next Sunday will be Palm Sunday. And 2 weeks from today will be Easter. Perhaps as we gather, we recognize that Lent seems long. It seems a bit of drudgery, something that we have to endure, something that we have to just get through in order to make it to someplace else. With that in mind, I'd like to say something about the covenant of the heart that Jeremiah speaks about. I'm going to create a slight liturgical faux pas, and that I plan on talking about St. Patrick, because it was yesterday. And then say something about this extraordinary question in the Greeks to Philip. Sir, we want to see Jesus. The covenant of the heart. An opportunity to be here on the first Sunday of Lent. And I challenge you to think about what Lent really was. Not just a time of giving something up, not just a time of taking something on, but something that we did on a pilgrimage that was about a schola affectus, a school of the heart, a school of the affections, something that was to change us within. And so it's so extraordinary in the prophet Jeremiah that it is made clear. It is no longer about the covenant in stone. So it's not about those tablets on Mount Sinai, where if you want to hold tradition, the finger of God writes the Ten Commandments. And they end up in the Ark of the Covenant. And the people believe and follow it and know that if they follow the Ten Commandments, they'll have life. It's an extraordinary testimony, and one we still stand in legacy of and possession of. But stones don't give life. And so Jeremiah is predicting the truth of Jesus Christ. That the covenant will be written in our hearts. We don't have to go someplace to get it. So we all come to Carmel to get it. The sisters are here and they're trying to get out. We come here and come to places to gather with people of the heart. And so you don't have to go to a monastery. You don't have to go on a particular retreat. You don't have to read a particular book. You don't have to attend a particular program. Those are all good things. It could be sacred and blessed, but they miss the fundamental point. That it is already written in our hearts. Very simply and directly, that God is love, and we're to love our neighbor. It is that simple, and it is so hard to do. We spend our whole lives sacrificing and learning and sinning and growing in grace in relationship to be able to embrace what's in our heart. Often it can be hard to discover what is there. It requires a level of silence, a level of contemplation, a level of openness, knowing that nothing we find is not of God. God dwells in us, that sacred dwelling place. And it is so clear and so manifested, infleshed in us as it was in Christ. An extraordinary thing, the covenant of the heart. To be renewed and be purified in this long Lenten journey. St. Patrick. Yesterday at the parish where I was, and he did it on purpose, I wore a purple chasuble and a green stole. To which people walked and hit the altar and said, Father, that doesn't go together. To which I have the response, believe me. In Baltimore, everything goes with purple. The child wasn't sure what to say to that response, but he was, yeah, that's probably true. There's something incredible about St. Patrick. Whether we believe he was really where a legend really misses the point. To think that 1,500 years later, we're still associating this person and and Catholicism with an extraordinary people. That's pretty significant. So you might know the basic story. It's 387, so they say he's born in Scotland, and somehow he ends up being captive as a slave with the Druids in Ireland. He gets back to Scotland, and he has a vision. And it's really easy, even if you're not particularly internet savvy, just type St. Patrick Confession. It's not a long document. But in the document, written by Patrick or not, again, I think the historicity is not the issue. A man appears to him, victorious, with a bunch of letters, and Patrick picks one of them. And he opens the letter. And in the text, it says in this vision to him, "Shepherd boy, come back and lead the people." And he hears this as the voice of the unchurched in Ireland. And so after being a slave, he goes back, and so the story goes, he pays off his owner, and he labors to bring Christianity to Ireland. 1,500 years, many, many people, in terms of their DNA, and in terms of their minds and hearts, stand in that legacy. I mean, no disrespect, but between Ireland, probably Spain and Italy, they've done more to set foundations for a Catholic Church, perhaps, in other countries. What an extraordinary thing to think it was. He goes back. You know, and he uses the things that people know. What was written in their heart. So he picks up the clover. And he says it's got three petals to it. This is what the Trinity is like. He was able to enter into the hearts and minds of the people. So the Christianity took root and did extraordinary things for the church and for the people of Ireland. So that they could come to know, as we sang in the beginning, that the Savior of the world would set them free by his cross and resurrection. What an incredible thing it was. And it's not about fighting the history. It's about saying, we still remember this. And yes, it has its secular parts. Of course, the other part that goes with this is you do know why St. Patrick died on March 17th. He died on March 17th because he was well aware that the Irish people could not go 40 days without a beer. Thus you have the truth of the death of St. Patrick. But I think it's important that we have heroines and heroes. People that we can go back to, and it doesn't matter the legendary pieces, because we can get all caught up in that. Still 1,500 years, it speaks to people, and it's not just secular. It immediately invites people to think about the Catholic Church. And I think that's important. You know, when I think of all the things that are associated with St. Patrick, maybe this is the best. Christ with me. Christ before me. Christ behind me, Christ in me. Christ beneath me, Christ above me. Christ on my right, Christ on my left. Christ when I lay down, Christ when I sit down. Christ when I arise. Christ in the heart of everyone who thinks of me. Christ in the mouth of everyone who speaks of me. Christ in every eye that sees me. Christ in every ear that hears. Legend maybe, truth certainly. Lastly, the fabulous question of Philip, to Philip from the Greeks. Sir, I want to see Jesus. Is that what informs our minds all the time? I want to see Jesus. It's a little bit of a sad story, but it's a powerful story for me. One of my heroes in the Jesuit was a man named Jack Carboy. Probably nobody really knows him, but he's from Philadelphia. He worked a little while at Blakefield, but mostly was at St. Joseph Prep and at the Chestnut Hill College in Philadelphia. Jack was dying of cancer just before I was being ordained in 1993 at our infirmary. And for the last 2 days of his life, he was on heroin. He never said anything other than this, and he was saying it. I don't think he slept. He probably said it every 3 minutes. I want to see Jesus. I want to see Jesus. I want to see Jesus. Jack's sister is the sister of St. Joseph in Philadelphia and was also with him. And she just kept saying to him, Jack, Jesus is waiting. Jesus is coming. With our dying breath, will it be, I want to see Jesus? And where do we go to see Jesus now? Well, we come to Eucharist. We come to community. But it has to be poured out in the broken and the oppressed. The gospel is clear. And the response is clear. You know, when did I see you hungry? When did I see you thirsty? When did I see you lonely and in prison? When did I see you naked? Patrick, the great immigrant. When did I see you as immigrant? As often as you did this for the least of my brothers and sisters, you did it for me. One of the other great places where we must find Christ is in the mirror. If we cannot find and believe that God is that heart, that new covenant written in our hearts, then it's going to be very tough to find it anywhere else. That doesn't make us God, but it makes us in the image and likeness and challenged profoundly to bring others to Jesus, to answer the question for them, a question they may not even be able to ask in today's day and age. You know, Patrick had this great vision of the man in the letters. Why? Because he wasn't filled with all the kinds of things that fill us. Do we think and reflect such that we can think about the dying of the weak and the rising to new life? Sir, we want to see Jesus. An extraordinary proclamation. So I guess in the end, on this fifth day of Lent, we come to recognize that really, if we're true to our hearts and true to our God, Lent is simply not long enough.